Right, today we are going to discuss about one of the poems which is prescribed in your syllabus. This is Boy's Kind by Stephen Crane. Let's discuss about the poem and introduction to the poet and the poetic techniques and important quotations and what kind of questions that they might ask for the exam. So before moving to the poem, let's have some identification about the poet. So I have given a small description here about the poet. Stephen Crane was born November 1st, 1871, Newark, New Jersey, United States. Died June 5 in 90s. Baden-Weiler, Baden, G.E.R., American novelist, poet and short story writer, best known for his novels Maggie, A Girl of the Streets, 1893, and The Red Badge of Courage, 1895, and the short stories The Open Boat, The Bride Comes to Yellow Sky, and The Blue Hotel. These are the notable literature work actually done by the poet. So, then he is known as an American poet, American novelist and poet who lived in America. So most of his poems actually were based on war, the conflict of war and the consequences of war. So we will try to understand about this poem as well and what are the poetic techniques and what kind of message is given by the writer through this poem. So I am directly coming to the introduction to the poem, stanza one. Do not weep, maiden, for war is kind, because your lover threw wild hands toward the sky. And the affrighted steed ran on alone. Do not weep, war is kind. Now, first and foremost, when we read the first stanza, you can understand. He gives us a clear explanation telling that, do not weep, maiden, war is kind. So he's talking to a maiden or else a lady, right? A lady, your lover means this lady can be the girlfriend. This lady can be the girlfriend. And this speaker is telling to that girl, now the lover is already dead from the war. I think he might be a soldier. So he died in the war zone. And the narrator comes to the girl and explains that there is no need of crying. No point of crying because now your lover is dead. There is no point of crying, but make sure to understand war is kind. Soon after you heard the topic of the poem, war is kind, you will realize that war is a certain place where a lot of bloodshedding will occur. People will attack, you. A lot of dead bodies can be seen. So it is not a place to be kind because your enemies are always trying to kill you and you are always trying to survive yourself and you try to kill the enemy. So this is not a place to be kind, right? So what kind of poetic technique here the writer or the poet tries to give? So at the very beginning of that, we can clearly understand with the concept of contrast and the ironical feeling is given. What it is said in the poem is not seen when you take the meaning of the poem inside, right? The poet tries to say, even though I said war is kind, the audience will understand that war is not actually kind, right? This is called irony, right? This is called irony. What you said is not what you mean. What you said is not what you mean. So this is called irony. Now here, suddenly when the lover died, definitely the girl will cry. There is no hard and fast rule because this is her lover. But according to the poet says there is no point of crying because now your husband, now your lover died. So there is no point of crying. Always make sure to remember war is kind. By telling this word, we can clearly understand in several places this phrase called war is kind. And do not weep can be seen throughout the poem, right? not only in the first stanza, until the fifth stanza, we can see this. So this is the way that the poet uses that irony in order to create the awareness among the audience about the cruel brutality of war. Actually, war is unkind. There is no kindness. There is no passion. There is no love in a war zone, right? But in order to pass that message properly, poet is using the word in a different manner. What he said is not what he means. This is called irony. Very powerful language expression. So what does the poet explain here? We will try to understand. I think you can read this. In the first stanza of War is Kind, the speaker begins by making use of the refrain. What do you mean by refrain? Refrain means you are abstaining. You are not doing the certain thing, right? He tells a maiden or an unmarried woman that she should not weep. She should not weep. There is no point of crying. War, he states, is kind. He tells that war is not something very unkind and brutal and inhuman. That is something very kind. So always you have to remember, by using this expression, he tries to evoke irony, ironical understanding. Soon after we read this poem, we will try to understand, we will think twice what he is telling. We actually personally know that war is not kind. War is inhuman. War is brutal, right? War is something that is rejected by the entire world. But this person says war is kind. This is a very powerful technique. This is obviously very unusual and likely ironic. I have highlighted that word. So if you are answering for this question for your ordinary level examination, definitely you have to remember the first and foremost thing that comes should come to your mind is irony, the usage of irony, right? He goes on to tell the woman that her lover threw his hands in the air. Now, the person is explaining the way he died. The person is explaining the way he died. His hands in the air when he was confronted with war. When this happened, his steed refers to horse, ran alone. Which means this soldier, this brave soldier went to the war with a horse, right? Soon after the death of the soldier, the horse ran alone because there is no owner. It was afraided. Afraided means the horse became afraid. A complicated way to say frightened, right? The word afraided refers to frightened. It is unclear what exactly happened to make the lover throw his hands in the air, right? Sometimes he might throw his hand in the air because he might thought that, okay, I lost the grip, or else, okay, I lost my gun. So the best possible way to show that I'm ready to give up my life is to raising my hands, or else sometimes he might be thinking that he got afraid for the enemies, and he might thought that they will give some kind of a freedom for him. So, however, he threw his hands into the air asking for freedom. Sometimes it might be asking for freedom, but unfortunately, he did not get that. However, now the lover was died. He passed away. Now the girl is crying. She might have a lot of hopes as a young girl after the marriage to have a beautiful family life with this person. But unfortunately, because of war, that love affair will be destroyed forever, right? Maybe it was in surrender, or perhaps something darker happened. He was injured or even killed. The way that he raised his hands can be, sometimes he might have surrender because at the end of the day, he might understood that there is no point of fighting. Or else it might be the darker ideas which occurred inside his mind and his heart. Or else he might be injured or even killed. So in the first stanza, we can get some kind of glimpse about war and what kind of fate that the soldiers face who confronted with this war zones. And the narrator is clearly expressing his personal idea to this young lady, telling that this is how your lover died, right? You should know about that, and I am telling you There is no point of crying because he already died. And make sure to remember, war is kind. Then we will go to the stanza 2. Horse booming drums of the regiment, little souls who thirst for fight. These men were born to drill and die. The unexplained glory flies above them. Great is the battle god, great and his kingdom. A field where 1,000 corpses lie. Right. So we will go to the second stanza. So the first word I have explained here, hoarse means a person's voice sounding rough and harsh, typically as the result of sore throat or of shouting. Now, hoarse whisper can be seen, especially if you have watched these Independence Day celebrations, where the captain is shouting in a hoarse voice, right? When they are going for the march past, he is giving his, all these messages and everything for the battalion, right? He was shouting in a large, louder voice. This is called hoarse. That sound can be heard. Booming drums, right? Booming drums. The sound effect is also used there. We will discuss about that when we are discussing about the poetic techniques. The booming drums of the regiment, right? So the sound effects can be heard, right? They are getting ready. Normally, when the nowadays we can't see that, but earlier days, when there was First World War, Second World War, they had a separate set of people who were there to play these drums, right? Those were known as the booming drums. And he personally says that about the little souls, right? Little souls who thirst for fight, right? These little souls expresses about the soldiers who are getting ready for a fight. We will try to understand that in the next slide. We will read that. His time, though, is referring to the drums played by the regiment of soldiers. Now, why these drums are played by the regiment of soldiers? Because it will increase their motivation, their caliber, right? When the booming drum sounds are heard by the soldiers, they will be motivated to go and fight. The hoarse sound can be heard, right? All the instructions are given to the battalion by the captain or the major, right? As if they are sick or in need of something to drink. They are in thirst, right? They are in thirst, not the physical thirst I am referring to. They are in thirst for a fight. Now, why this? Who made this thirst? This thirst is made by the booming drum sound and the hoarse voice made by the major or the captain. Now the soldiers know that they are going for a fight. They are waiting for that. Can you understand that? It's very difficult to understand, but you have to read the poem very carefully. Not the thirst to drink something, right? Not the thirst to drink something. Here, they are in thirst for a fight. Now they are ready, because when you are going for a war, sometimes you will have certain mentality that whether I will die, what will happen to me, whether I will be injured likewise. So all these doubts are cleared by the regiment and the booming drums. They have been given a certain motivation from that, right? From the booming drums and the hoarse voice. In the two lines, the speaker says that soldiers are, in the inverted commas, I have used that in the inverted commas. Can you see that? Little souls. And are thirsting not for water, but for fight. See, you have to understand. Thirst means not the water. Thirst means not the water. The little souls are getting ready for a fight here, right? They are getting ready for a fight. The phrase little souls is interesting here. Why is that? It contrasts with the next line, which seems to suggest the men do not have souls, right? These men do not have any purpose in their life. They don't feel love. They don't feel passion. They don't have any sexual desires, right? They were like robots. Why? Because in the next stanza, it clearly says they were born to drill and die. They were born to drill and die. All these soldiers are there in the world only to serve for one purpose. That is to fight for their motherland and give up their lives for that. Not to live a happy life, not to have happiness, not to be a father, not to have a happy family life, not to have any luxurious life, nothing like that. His entire life is dedicated. Entire life is dedicated. His dreams are shattered. He doesn't have any other ambitions in his life. His entire life is dedicated for war. Right? That is why the writer says, these people were born to drill and die. So they have a little soul. They don't have a full soul. What kind of heart that they have? They don't have actually a heart. They have destroyed it themselves. Because when you have a heart, you will feel passion. You will feel kindness. You will feel love. So with that, you can't fight with an enemy. With that, you can't take a gun and kill somebody. You can't do that, right? So because of that reason, the poet says, these people are trained. These people are trained. They were born to drill and die. These people are trained to go to the battlefield, fight with your enemy. Sometimes you will die. If you are lucky, you will survive, right? So the poor state of the soldiers, poor state of the soldiers are explained in here. So you can understand that. So here, there's a very beautiful contrast. In this line, it says, poor souls. And the next line, he explains that these soldiers want to drill and die, born to drill and die, so they don't have a soul, right? They are only kind of robots. They will only follow the instructions given by the captain or the regiment leader or the major, right? They can't think. They don't have that thinking capacity. It was destroyed. They were kind of robots. They were ready to go for the war. They were ready to serve their leaders under any crucial circumstances. This is the real state of the soldiers where Stephen Crane tries to explain us, right? Then let's continue. The speaker goes on to say that these men were born for nothing else other than to fight. I have highlighted that. I think you can see that. Then they went born to drill as in train and practice. Most of you might have done the drill practice for these sports meets and all, right? Drill. So there should be a certain practice because all of you maintain the same rhythm and all of you have to maintain the same uniform. So same thing happens here. These soldiers are practiced really well for one thing, that is for war, nothing else. They don't have any personal ambitions. They don't have any personal dreams. They don't have any personal achievements. Their whole life is dedicated to the war zone. They are that type of people. They are mechanical in their actions and their purpose. I think you can very clearly understand that. That is the meaning of the stanza number 2. Okay, we will move on. Then stanza number 2 furthermore says, in the fourth line, the speaker references unexplained glory. There is no glory for anyone in a war because both parties will lose their lives and a lot of property will be destroyed, right? Unexplained glory flies above them. There's a certain line like that. It is in the fourth line. Unexplained glory flies above them, right? So unexplained glory refers to the glory that even they can't even explain. What kind of glory that man will have after killing another man? After killing another man, what kind of glory he will take? Just imagine, war is something that nobody cannot explain what kind of glory that they will have. Both parties will get injured. Both parties will lose their lives, not only the lives, but also the property. So if one is arguing that, no, we have this patriotism, we are fighting for our motherland, that is a different case. But here, Stephen Crane tries to show that all the innocent people who joined with these army forces, they lose their lives without no valid reason. Even they don't know why they are fighting, and even they don't know what kind of glory that they will have. And this unexplained glory flies above them, right? Furthermore, something which spectators and outsiders from war imbue upon these who were in war. Sometimes people who are outside, now our Sri Lankans, normally we tend to believe that they are our war heroes. They are heroes. Nobody can't do that. They are a separate type of a people, separate set of people. They are a set of heroes. We can tell number of things because we are outsiders. We are outsiders. But if you go inside and see, they are having a very difficult, very suffocated lifestyle inside the uniform. Inside the uniform. So nobody knows what kind of glory that they are keeping to them. These innocent soldiers don't have any idea about that. Most of the soldiers are joining with these army forces because they don't have any employment opportunities. That is the truth. Very less amount of people join with armies with the patriotism. Very less amount of people when it comes to the youth. Right? Then furthermore, it says, glory is not something that actively seeks out soldiers on the battlefield. No. Right? It is not actively seeks out by anybody inside the battlefield. Most of them are trying to survive. Most of them are trying to survive. That is why they are shooting the enemy before the enemy shoots them, because they want that survival. Right? The contrast between the flag and the soldiers can be seen here, because this is the unexplained glory. It flies above them, right? So sometimes it might be the flag of the regiment which flies above them. So that is the unexplained glory. Soldiers are down. Flag will be up every day, each and every day, until the soldiers have captured the certain landscape. So it is a beautiful contrast, right? The soldiers are the people who are doing all the hard work on the ground. But the flag will do nothing. The flag will do nothing, but every day the flag will be there up, showing the glory to the whole wide world. But nobody sees the huge sacrifice done by these innocent soldiers. Can you understand that? That idea is there here, right? That points to huge gap between the glory fighting on the battlefield and the grand purpose of the war high above the all the mess, right? That kind of great responsibility is they are on the shoulders of the soldiers, right? That is the glory that other people take. But unfortunately, even the soldiers don't have any idea why they are fighting for what they are fighting for, right? Then furthermore says, in the last lines of the section, the speaker mentions a battle god, a battle god. Where the last line it says, the kingdom, the god is the battle, and the God's kingdom is the battlefield. There's a beautiful metaphor we call, right? That is the idea given to the soldiers. You are doing a battle. This battle is very similar to a god, right? And your battlefield is the kingdom of God, where the 1,000 corpses are lying. Think about the situation. That kind of mentality is made inside the mind of soldiers. That is the mentality, right? We will read this. There are a number of different gods who could fit this description. According to Stephen Crane, he explains that battle is a god. There are a number of gods who are taking this place when it comes to Greek mythology, when it comes to other types of mythologies. We can understand there are different types of gods who ensure the battle, who ensure the war, right? Then, but the exact name does not matter. What the speaker is doing here is setting out a scene which is ruled differently than another kingdom. This particular kingdom is nothing more than a field where 1,000 corpses lie. Even though the poet says that you are fighting in the kingdom of God. This kingdom is full of bloodshedding. This kingdom is full of corpses, right? Where 1,000 corpses are lying, not only from the enemies, but also from the army. So both parties were damaged, both parties were highly damaged, and a lot of soldiers died. So those dead bodies can be seen here and there. What kind of mental picture or visual imagery is created by the poet in this stanza, right? It is dark and terrible place which is ruled over by a powerful force. This place is completely ruled by a powerful force. So here you have to understand one thing. The god is known as the battle, and the battlefield is clearly, directly shown to the kingdom of the God. This one you have to identify very carefully inside the second stanza. That is how the second stanza ends. Then we are moving to stanza number 3. Right, let's read stanza number 3. Do not weep, babe, for war is kind. Again, we can see that repetition. Do not weep. In the first stanza also we saw this. It is about a maiden. Now here we are talking about a girl, small girl, or else a daughter. Because your father tumbled in the yellow trenches, tumbled. Now we are dealing with the father. In the first stanza, we deal with the young boy whose lover or the girlfriend is crying with extreme pain because she lost her lover. Now in the third stanza, we are dealing with the girl Girl means a daughter. Now the daughter has lost his father. What happened to the father? Father went to the war zone and he lost his life. Now how he lost his life? Each and every stanza, the poet is explaining about the way that he lost his life, which is very brutal and inhuman. Just think about the situation. You are in a funeral zone, in a funeral house, right? The dead bodies, they are in front of you. And you can't go and tell to the neighbors, do you know how did this person die? I will tell you from one by one. First, but this is the first step. This is the second step. Can you tell like that? Can you understand what kind of pain it will give to the people, the loved ones, right? They will definitely chase you away. So same thing is done by this poet. Why he is doing such inhuman thing? Because he wants to show the whole wide world what kind of negative effects are there inside the bow. What kind of terrible incidents, terrible experience faced by these innocent soldiers who don't know, who don't have any idea about war whatsoever. They just joined with the armies or else the forces since because they don't have any employment opportunities. This is the bitter truth that we have to expect whether we like it or not, right? So that is the basic idea. Then, in the third stanza, the speaker being asked by a babe, babe means a daughter, do not weep because the reason is he has moved on from addressing a woman to speaking to a young child. He tells the child that there is no reason to weep and then provides them with a very good reason to do so. Why you are crying? There is no point of crying because your father tumbled in the yellow trenches and he gulped mud and he died. He had a very terrible, he faced a very terrible death. His death cannot be explained by myself. That much inhuman death. Do you know how he died? Then he explains. See the brutality of war. The child's father, who was in a battle of some kind, died in the yellow trenches. He had a rage in his breast and in the simplest way, gulped and died. He gulped and died. The rage refers to his own thirst for war, as I have explained. He wanted to join with the war. He wanted to kill other people. That bravery, that boldness was there inside him. Understood? Then, and to the injury which killed him, the bullet entered his body, driven by another's rage. Now, from that side, another person is also there just like him, with the same emotions, with the burning rage to have a fight, right? So the bullet entered to his body from another person who shot him, and that kind of suffocation is suffered by himself as well. The refrain is again repeated, do not weep for his kind, do not weep for his kind, the refrain, right? Several times it is repeated. It is starting to become even more haunting as its deep irony is made clear. Now you can clearly understand each and every stanza. We can understand the irony is there as a very powerful poetic technique. We will discuss about that when it comes to poetic techniques. Now I have explained three stanzas. Let's move into the other slide. We are discussing about the fourth stanza. Swift blazing flag of the regiment, eagle with crest of red and gold. Now we are dealing with that beautiful flag of the regiment. What do we have on the flag? Eagle with crest of red and gold. Eagle is symbolizing power, right? Crest of red. Red is symbolizing the boldness or the blood, and gold means the glory. Highly symbolical, my dear children. Highly symbolical, right? So the eagle, why they have used the, you have a poem called Eagle by Alfred Lord Tennyson. So in that we discuss about the ultimate power and aggression and the charisma that the eagle had. So the same thing is explained here. So that is why they have used eagle's picture or else the image for their regiment flag. These men were born to drill and die. Again, the poet is explaining the same thing. Don't worry, because they were participating on a drill. They have practiced really well how to fight and they have practiced really well how to die as well. Point for them, the virtue of slaughter. Slaughter means killing a lot of people together, right? And it is taken as something virtue. Virtue means venerable, right? Or else given much more importance, added some sacredness for that. Okay. Killing a lot of people in a war zone is something very valuable. Something will add some kind of virtue to your life. It is taken as something venerable. sacred, but we have to argue with the fact that we will get nothing by killing another man. Whatever the purpose, as a human being, you will gain nothing by killing another man. But inside a war zone, my dear children, it is taken as something excellent. It is taken as something virtuous. It is taken as something very valuable. It is taken as something very important. And some value will be added for them. This is how they were practiced. Make plain to them the excellency of killing. Killing is taken as something excellent. Right? Excellent. Better than good. Excellent. And a field where 1,000 corpses lie. Where the poet never forgets to explain about this place. Where most of the people gave up their lives from both parties. And their dead bodies can be seen here and there. Very suffocative situation. We will read this. The flag of the regiment is mentioned in the fourth stanza of War is Kind. It is blazing and patterned with a crest of red and gold and an eagle. There is another moment of repetition in which the line, "These men were born to drill and die," is used again. It is a reminder, and its reuse helps to create a rhythm to the poem. Along with the refrain, "Do not weep, war is kind," the poem starts to sound song-like. So each and every stanza, we have this refrain. So it seems like it is not a poem, it is actually a song, because the same stanza, same line rather, is repeating again and again. Then we are going to stanza number 4 for the discussion. In line 4 through 6 of this stanza, the speaker goes through some terrible images. He speaks to the flag and tells it to make sure that men know that there is virtue in slaughtering one's enemies and there is excellence in killing. The stanza ends with the repetition of the line, "And the field where 1,000 corpses lie." Right? Okay, we will move with the slides. Right. Then we move on to stanza number 5. "Mother, whose heart hung humble as a button on the bright splendid shroud of your son, do not weep, war is kind." Here, we have another perspective. Now, from the beginning, we had two perspectives. Number one, the poet discussed about a young boy who is not married, how his lover or the girlfriend was suffocating and crying painfully because he passed away in a war zone. Number two, we discussed about a father who is married and who had a daughter, and how the daughter suffocated because his father died in a terrible manner inside the war zone. Now we are coming to the third perspective, how a mother is suffocating because his only son, one and only son, died because of war zone. What kind of torment, what kind of torture, what kind of agony that she goes through in this poem is explained by the poet in this stanza using a simile as well. A beautiful simile which we call metonymy. We will discuss about that as well. The speaker has addressed a maiden and a babe, and now he addresses a mother. Using a simile, he remarks that this mother's heart hung humble as a button on the shroud of her son. This mother's heart hung humble as a button on the shroud of her son. The heart is doing the hanging because sometimes when talking about somebody's emotional reaction or affection or sadness, we say heart, as in my heart grieves for that woman. So here they have used a very rare poetic technique, right? So the heart of the girl, heart of the woman is actually compared to hanging as a button. So my heart is hanging. My heart here, hanging refers to, grieves refers to, heart refers to that extreme sadness. So this technique is known as metonymy. We will discuss about that in this stanza. That is little thing we like to call metonymy. Speaking of hanging, what's going on with the phrase? First, imagine a button hanging on a shirt. Metonymy is a figure of speech in which one object or idea takes the place of another with which it has a close association. In fact, metonymy means change of name. As a literary device, it is a way of replacing an object or idea with something related to it instead of stating what is actually meant. Metonymy enables writers to express a word or thought, a word or thought in a different way by using a closely related word or thought. Therefore, this is a method for writers to vary their expression and produce an effect for the reader. So here they have used a simile as well as a metonymy. What do you mean by metonymy? Metonymy is refers to using a different type of a name or different type of a gesture rather instead of the original one in order to associate with the meaning. So let's take some examples, then you can understand. See here. Here are some examples of metonymy. Now, the metonymy we have used here is the heart to show the sadness, right? Show the sadness. But see my examples, then you will understand. Here are some examples of metonymy that may be found in every expression. What is the word Hollywood? What does that express? Represents association with the movie industry. Turf, what does it represent? Represents association with area of residence or expertise. Feds, represents associations with government law enforcement. Press, represents associations with news organizations, especially newspapers. Breeze, represents associations with something that is simple, straightforward, or easy. Using one word which relevance to the entire field is known as, which relevant to the entire field of that word is known as the metonymy. It is a new poetic technique that you are going to use. When people are dealing with the movie industry, when they are suddenly moving to the television industry, to movie industry, we call that silver screen. Silver screen, right? Silver screen refers to the movies, not for the television. Likewise, there are certain words that we use to take the meaning or the evoke the meaning. Here in this poem, he has used heart humble as a button. Humble as a button refers to, or the heart refers to the sadness that she has been going through in her life, because at the end of the day, she lost her son. Then we are moving to the poetic devices, my dear children. In this 5-stanza excerpt from Voice Kind by Stephen Crane, the poet does not use any pattern of rhyme or rhythm. Any pattern of rhyme or rhythm. In fact, the whole poem is written in free verse. In fact, the whole poem is written in free verse. But that does not mean that there are moments of rhyme or techniques used to create rhythm. For example, the endings of lines like 1 and 5 of stanza 1 rhyme with the words kind and kind. So do lines 3 and 6 of stanza 2 with die and lie. So there are here and there are some rhyming words, but it does not continue like the poem that we have studied previously, which is the poem that we have studied in the previous one. That is the humorous poem we discussed. There we had a very beautiful rhyming scheme, double A, double B, double C, right? But here we do not find something like that. The poem by Raymond Wilson, Two's Company, you have a beautiful rhyming scheme, rhyming words. But here and there you have some rhyming words, but it doesn't mean that the poem comes under the category of a rhyming pattern. So the poem doesn't have any rhyming pattern. That type of poems are known as free verse. In addition to these full rhymes, there are half or slant rhymes. These are also scattered around the text and connect one another due to assonance. What do you mean by assonance? Same vowel sound repeated again and again. Regiment and fight in stanza 2. Another example is kind and wild in stanza 1, which are related to their similar long I sounds. So when the I sound is repeated, assonance refers to all the sounds of vowel. So A, E, I, O, U. So this I sound is made here. So it can be taken as assonance. The examples are regiment, fight, and kind and wild. So the I sound can be heard. It is taken as assonance. Then we have poetic devices, syntax or diction. What do you mean by syntax? What do you mean by diction? Diction or syntax is known as using the correct word for the correct place, especially when you are writing a poem or a novel. The selection of the correct words are known as diction. Throughout the poem, Crane uses phrases that are emotionally heavy to appeal to the reader's emotions. An example of this appeal to the reader's emotion is mother whose heart hung humble as a button. This appeals to the reader's emotion because even though the mother's child has passed away, she is still humbled because he died fighting for something he believed in. Also, Crane uses of the maiden and babe allow the readers to realize that he has written the poem for a female. Crane could be writing this for a female due to the majority of the time in which the poem was written in, only men were allowed to fight in wars. Only men were allowed to fight in wars. I think you can clearly understand. You don't need any explanation for that. You can read it. Women were forced to stay and care for the children and houses. So all the people that he has taken here are female characters who suffocated from the problem, right? They are the daughter and the girlfriend and the and mother. All these people suffocated because they are loved ones, they are males, went to war because they didn't have any alternative in their lives. So diction is perfect, syntax is perfect, the perspective is really good for this type of a poem. So he has done the work quite remarkably well. Then we have imagery, one of the major, one of the very powerful poetic techniques that we have in the syllabus. There are several types of imageries when it comes to literature: visual imagery, tactile imagery, auditory imagery likewise. Now, basically in this poem, we have visual imagery. Throughout the poem, Crane uses specific imagery to allow the reader to visualize that he is discussing. The first imagery in the poem is the affrighted steed ran and on alone. This imagery is used for the readers to picture a frightened horse running extremely fast by itself. When we read that, all the mental pictures will come to your mind. This is called visual imagery. In times of war, it was a common thing for regiments to see horses run around by themselves because the rider was murdered in action. I think most of these scenes you might have seen in Hollywood movies. Most of the time, when it comes to all these Hollywood movies, you can clearly see these incidents as visual imagery. Then, the second piece of imagery Crane uses in his poem is the booming drums. The booming drums always can be taken as an onomatopoeic expression as well, or else under the auditory imagery. The certain drum parts that they use for the war, right? So it is also taken, can be taken as auditory imagery. By using the imagery, the readers can visualize the regiment lining up to fight with the booming drums playing with their theme song. Sometimes you can add some trumpet sound as well, right? Some trumpet sound as well. You might have seen movies, so you can clearly visualize what I am explaining here. A field where 1,000 corpses lie is another form of imagery. When it is a battlefield, we can clearly understand what kind of place is that. You can clearly understand there are no beautiful rainbows and beautiful flowers, right? People are running here and there. Some people have lost their limbs. Some people have lost some parts of their bodies, and all these bullets, guns and all these tanks are everywhere, right? The black color smoke is going here and there. So that background picture can be made by yourself in your mind. This is called the power of imagery, right? Even though you are not in that place, by reading the poem, you can go to that place from your memory, from your mind, from your mental pictures. This is called the power of the writer, right? By using this imagery, can better understand that war is not really kind because thousands of individuals die and are left to rot in the fields. They have not even given a proper death, or else proper funeral ceremony also not given for them. They died in rot on the field. The last image that the reader can visual is troop dying. Readers can visual this because Crane specifically describes his death, raged and his breast gulped and died. Then we go for the tone. What do you mean by the tone as a poetic device? After closely analyzing the poem, readers realize that the tone of the poem is sarcastic. What do you mean by sarcastic? Full of laughter. How did he build that? Through irony. Through irony. What he said was not what he was meant, right? What he said was not what he was meant. The tone is sarcastic because throughout the poem, Crane says that war is kind, but within the stanzas, Crane does not use facts to support this claim. He says war is kind. By saying that word, he shows us war is not kind. It is unkind, right? The imagery and word choice help the reader analyze the sarcastic tone in the poem. An example of imagery that applies to sarcastic tone is line 14 through 16. In these lines, Crane describes a soldier dead. However, in the follow two lines, Crane says, "Don't cry because war is kind." Nothing about men sacrificing their lives to fight in a war is kind, right? In a war zone, nobody can see that kind of a kindness. This is there to help the sarcastic tone. We don't have a pathetic tone here. Somebody can argue that we normally have a pathetic tone because all the people died in a terrible manner. One can come with that argument as well. But most of the time, because of the irony, we can see sarcasm as a tone in this poem. Then when we come to themes, what are the themes that we have to follow in this poem? The devices or the poetic themes. After closely analyzing the poem, the readers can come to the conclusion that the theme of the poem is that war is really not kind at all. That is the moral message given in the poem as well, using the irony. Readers can come to the conclusion by analyzing the word choices. Give me another word for word choices: diction, imagery, and tone. Since the tone of the poem is sarcastic, the readers can conclude that when Crane mentions that war is kind, he really means the opposite. This is called irony. What he was said is not what he meant, right? Also, the imagery that Crane provides throughout the poem represents all the horrid aspects of a war. So it is a beautiful description by a poet about the real life situation of a war. And it is very beautiful how he saw war in three different perspectives. In three different perspectives. The perspective of a daughter, a perspective of a girlfriend, a perspective of a mother. How she felt, how she suffocated, and what kind of terrible agony that she went through because of this incident. So it is a very good poem with good moral message and good expressions and very good powerful poetic devices. Right? That is what you have to identify. Then we are moving to target questions. The suffocation of war is not for the dead ones, but for the living ones. Now, inside the poem, who are the living ones? The daughter. So you have to explain about how the daughter suffocated, how her father died, and how she suffocated. And the first one, how the maiden suffocated, how her lover died. Because of her lover died, what kind of terrible lifestyle that she had to go in her life. Before starting her beautiful life, she ended her life, all the dreams scattered. The only son died, so how mother suffocated from that. Actually, there is metonymy as well. How her heart humble, how her heart fell down as a button or trembled as a button, as a humble button of the shroud of her son inside the war zone. So these three characters you have to take into consideration and you have to explain your answer. I have given that here. The poem begins with the pain of separation between a maiden and her lover who died on the battlefield. To heighten the tragic effect, the persona describes the last moment of the dying lover who threw wild hands towards the sky, which clearly explains us what kind of pain and what kind of agony that he went through when he ended up his life inside the war zone. In a frenetic state, as he fell from his horse while the affrighted steed ran and alone, a perspective reader will note that ambivalent tone on the persona. On one hand, there is sympathy for the maiden's unfulfilled love. On the other hand, there is sympathy for the soldier's agony. So both are there. So that is the explanation that I have to give here. So basic explanation. I personally think that you can write an answer for this question and you can send that answer to me. Did you write the previous two questions and did you send me the answers? You didn't, right?
So I have written it. I have to only take a photo and send it to you. But
please send, because then only I can guess that whether you will get the idea and all. So from that, we will stop today. Tomorrow, you have any class?
Sir, I have another question. In the second question, I'm struggling with that answer. So can you
explain that. Yes. What was the question?
It was about wave.
Right. Okay.
I am having trouble with the wave prose as well. If you can.
Yeah, I can explain that. Then tomorrow we will have a class and I will explain that. At what time you are free tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Or else the next day, we can take the next day.
We'll take the next day.
Okay, then tomorrow you tell me a time period, I will get ready, yeah?
Okay, sir.
Okay, Buddha, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.